Okay. Go ahead and start. Where do you start on this?
Okay.
Or?
Yeah, the main part that you want to open up would be the body cavity, which lies kind of roughly behind the operculum to the cloaca. So we'll want to cut kind of a flap off of the side of the animal.
And how deep do you want to go in something like this?
You just kind of want to go underneath the skin, although there is a body wall with some muscle in it, and you'll feel it. I like to go ahead and take the pectoral fin off on one side so it doesn't get in the way, and you can even take a pelvic fin off on one side. Well, there it goes.
Definitely see that bone-like structure.
Yeah, those spines, again, hit those pretty hard. And then as you hold it, usually facing you, so you want to cut like this structure out here. So I usually start at the cloaca, and you can kind of go in, and you can use, scalpels are okay, but I like to use scissors because you can feel that body wall and kind of push up against it with your lower part of your scissors, and that way you can, you know, kind of prevent you from cutting too deep, hopefully.
You can hear those scales too.
Yeah, they kind of crunch.
Definitely crunchy.
Up to at least the lateral line, probably.
Okay.
And then
you always take more, I guess.
Yeah, you get up into the muscle group, so it gets a little harder. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going to extend this one forward a little bit to make it a little easier to cut. So you kind of go along the belly here, up at least through that girdle where the fins are.
No, but definitely be a cavity in there we're looking for.
Yeah, and now let's see if we should be able to. Might have to break a little bit loose here, but yeah, hopefully you can kind of. There he goes. You can kind of see here we are breaking that open. Let me cut that.
It's definitely a cavity there we're getting into.
So you can cut into this big body cavity, this big coelom that these animals have. Looks like I can.
Any way to tell from before we began, the male or female or hard?
I'm not enough of a ichthyologist, I suspect, to do that. Some people probably can't. If you're kind of looking, we suspected this one was female because her belly's kind of enlarged.
Sure.
And usually the eggs and the ovaries are larger.
In comparison to this one here.
In compared to that one, yeah, you can kind of see, a little more.
If you're
going we're expecting that one to be a male. Probably. But externally, there isn't, you know, a lot of difference. And so as we take, you know, we just want to cut.
So as you're cutting here, as far as, we talk about male and female, internal reproduction?
Yeah, then you can, once we see the reproductive structures, the gonads.
Will they fertilize internal then, or?
No, the females will lay the eggs externally, and the males will spread the gametes, the sperm over them.
Any type of parental care at all with these then? Or
I don't know with perch so much. There's a few things like bass and bluegills and a few that will guard nests and things like that, and some fries. So it's some of the fish, there is some external care. I'm going to use a scalpel to kind of cut through this muscle here. We got some muscle. We went up pretty high on this one, which is good because that'll give us a little better look at things. So you basically want to pull that flap off. And like I say, anywhere it sticks, just kind of.
You do have two sides also.
Right, you can do right. Yeah, you can always.
Two students could do it, or you can
two
sides
could,
look
yeah,
at.
Yeah, you could come in from either side. And now. See that flap? Now I'll cut that.
Definitely some thick skin there, isn't there?
Yeah, and you can see the muscle in there too. I mean, they have some muscle in their body wall, which those are ribs. I was cutting through some ribs there. And that space. And now we'll just.
Help if I hold that there?
Yeah, I want to hold that.
You want to hold this like this?
Hold that so that maybe we can see what we're doing here. And we'll probably have to trim that back a little bit here in a minute. But that's the basic.
I just mentioned, you know, for the students too, this would be laying flat, but we're trying to show it here for the camera, so we're cutting a little different.
Yeah, and so let me take a little bit more muscle off of there, just so we can see it a little bit better. There we go. Yeah, so you can see one thing, this is definitely a female, and so a lot of the body cavity, it looks like almost, you know, probably two-thirds of it, is taken up by this large gonad, the ovary, which is full of eggs.
Oh, you can see
and
there.
You can see it where we kind of nicked it there a little, those tiny little structures.
So that's what made it enlarge the belly there,
So she was probably getting close to maturity. Each one of those tiny ones then would develop into eggs. So you can see these things have tremendous reproductive capacity. They can produce thousands and thousands of eggs each.
And that'd
individual.
Be released out of that common area?
Released out of the cloaca. I think
so. Probably got to remove all that. Or what's the best?
Yeah. I was going to say before we do that, right up here too is a very important structure. We've got to cut through there, but you can see it's a balloon-like or bag of air. That's the swim bladder, And swim bladders are another really important evolutionary adaptation in these ray fin fish because it acts, gives them buoyancy. So just like having a inner tube or something like that around yourself, it's going to help you suspend yourself in the water, move up, and so they can float. So without swimming, they can, they don't sink to the bottom.
Sure.
They will maintain their level of
depth in the water.
Depth in the water, and they can move. And then they can fish. There's some of them, like carp and minnows and things like that, that can swallow air and put that into their air bladder. These type of ray fin fish, if there's no external connection, instead it's all through blood vessels. But they can, through releasing gas from their blood vessels and pulling gas back into their blood vessels, they can, to a certain degree, regulate
the degree, up and down
the degree of the buoyancy.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, so that swim bladder has been was a very, very important adaptation that probably led to the success of this group.
Mm-hmm. You don't see that in sharks then?
Nope, and sharks don't have a swim bladder, right? It's just these osteichthyes, the bony fish.
So it
gives rise to, it's a sac coming off the digestive tract. It's actually also in later animals, it becomes lungs. They become those air sacs evolve into lungs.
Interesting. But as far as most of space, is that reproductive?
Yeah, in this case, I think, like I say, I think if I were, you know, doing this, I'd go ahead and try to, as carefully as we can here, remove that ovary and it's huge, as you can see.
It's unbelievable, yeah.
Yeah, and I say, well, probably. And see, so here, the whole of the digestive tract's just gotten squished down into the bottom here. So if your students are looking at a female like this, particularly one of the things are, it's, you know, maybe, you know, a little hard to see, because there's the intestine going down to the...
So you may show up a little bit, yeah, like that for your daily.
Yeah, going down to the cloaca, and then here's the spleen, this gray structure's the spleen, and so everything's gotten really pushed.
Just compressed
back,
down from
back into there. So I think we'll have to cut up into there a little bit just to even see some of those things. It's gotten so pushed back. So I think if we...
Just because of the massive size of the...
Yeah, just because of the amount of energy and resources they put into reproduction. So we'll cut a little of that operculum off, and then we'll cut...
Kind of hold that for you? That'd be easier? Or maybe
maybe I better grab hold of it.
Yes. Definitely going to some thicker bone there.
Yeah, so there's a little... Want to be careful with your students cutting through there. Another reason why I use scissors rather than scalpel. It's kind of a touch and go with a scalpel. There we go. So we opened up a little bit more of that. Yeah, you can hold him now there, or her now. So now, you can see, so here's the air bladder we saw before, swim bladder. This large structure up right at the anterior part of the cavity is the liver. So, and in most vertebrates, livers are very large structures. So here's the, you know, detoxify things. So here's almost all of this white material. Here's the liver. And then here's the digestive system under that, the intestine. Here's the stomach back here. I think we might look at the male to get a little better look at that.
Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, you know, this is, you look at a book, it isn't always exactly what you find.
Yeah, yeah, right.
Just because of the season and
season type of, yeah, say depending on the, you know, time of year you caught it, whether those gonads might be very reduced in some cases. Mm-hmm. So
we try identifying what we can here,
sure,
and then we'll cut.
Well, like I say, I don't think we see too much of the air bladder. We can see here's the intestine for sure running to the back. Here's the spleen with its gray, which it has immune function. Here's the liver. Here's more of the intestine here. Now they were pulling out a little bit more, it comes out a little bit better. Yeah. Here's the, you can see parts of the intestine, and this is part of the stomach up here. If I can get my thumb there. Whoops, I broke a little piece of liver off, that's probably good, because now we can see the stomach better, right there.
Well, should we go ahead and try cutting into this one a little quicker and see if we can make a comparison? Hope it's a male, and we can kind of
make comparisons.
Yeah,
and then we can kind of come back and
back and forth
take
there.
A look. Again, we'll do this one pretty
kind of the same
fast.
Process.
Yeah, same process. I take fins usually, and then I guess I usually start at the cloaca and cut up and then along the belly. Oops, squirting a little fluid out there under pressure. Go ahead and go through that bony girdle there, the pectoral girdle. I don't think I'll try to go up quite so far this time, so we won't worry about the muscle up there so much.
Any way to tell you if it's a male or female? It almost looks like a little female there, doesn't it, again?
Yeah, I think you're right. I think we got another female. Shoot.
Well, if we do, we can see how this looks for size, and we can always cut one more and then cut into that too.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't look like it's quite as, the ovary's large, but maybe not quite as large as it was in that other one. Yeah, this is not surgery there. Yeah, so again, here's the ovary and the air bladder, but you can see if you kind of, let's take that ovary out again, and now you can see a little bit more. Here's the spleen with its dark color, and the liver, in this case the liver is kind of dark, almost a brown color, and so there would be part of the stomach as that comes down.
Here's so the stomach comes off, probably the esophagus.
Yeah, and these branches, these are really large. There's some branches, usually some blind-end sacs that come off between where the stomach and intestine come together. These are called pyloric ceca, and they're like storage structures. Food will be stored in there. Mm-hmm. Bacterial action will work on them, and that sort of thing.
Then they come off the stomach into the intestine?
Yeah.
So stomach looking at storage probably more, and intestine
stomach in the storage, and intestine is more for, breaking things down and absorbing. Okay, well, not perfect.
How about a heart?
Let's go ahead and say we need to do a little more dissection now. We want to go up the heart. It's usually right underneath the gills. So you want to take this cut on up along the corner of the mouth there and take a nice chunk of him out there. And want to open up this area. Where did I cut that? There it is.
As far as how deep, just kind of
just through the muscle, here. Through the muscle layers, you'll
you can kind of see. I guess there's a cavity.
Yeah, it's right
cavity
down there.
There.
It's another cavity, so you get the pericardial cavity now, where the heart is located. I can cut a little more muscle out of there. Got a fair amount of muscle right above that, where run the gills and the operculum.
Definitely start to see it there, though.
Yeah, let me get that one piece of. Peel out of there. Yeah, now might be better to.
And kind of hold it back here too.
You want to hold it. I think I just need to get. There's a pericardial sac, as you'd expect. There we go.
There's nice. You see the lung or the gills there too.
Yeah. Here are the gills. Yeah, beautiful picture of the gills there. You can see there's several folds, a lot of surface areas. Water flows over there, and then those would be blood vessels would be in there picking up that oxygen. And then the heart. The blood, of course, is pumped over the gills by the heart, which is right here. And you can see it's still not a large structure, but compared to any invertebrate or something, the heart's really large. And so here's the two-chambered heart. This structure right here is the ventricle, where most of the pumping pressure mm-hmm. comes from. And this more sac-like structure right behind it is the atrium. So the deoxygenated blood would come into the atrium, into the ventricle, and then pumped up through this conus arteriosus structure to the gills, pick up oxygen, and then out mm-hmm. to the rest of the body. So it's a big loop.
Sure.
From, oxygenated, once the blood picks up oxygen in the gills, it goes out and delivers that oxygen to the tissues. Deoxygenated blood again comes back in on this side, into the atrium, into the ventricle, back to the gills. So I say a small heart by maybe other vertebrate standards, but a pretty important structure in moving that blood quickly around the body to mm-hmm. deliver oxygen, which allows for greater movement. Greater activity.
How about any type of urinary system? Is that
functioning?
Yeah, kidney.
It's going to be hard to see. It's kidneys.
Okay.
And the kidneys are hard to see. They're kind of up here lining the back of the animal. They're almost like in the tissue. They're really hard. They're actually in the wall itself. They're like the things.
Goes to that common area.
And then would urinary, would produce urine that then comes down, goes out the cloacal area.
Anything else we need to identify on here for now, you think?
Well, I don't think on this one there's too much more to see. We'll try to, maybe try the another one to see if we can see if it's a male or not.
Okay. All right. We were able to find an example of both a male and female.
Yeah.
As far as even a book, books all look a little different.
Yeah.
Here's three examples.
To say if you're looking at this and immediately, I think you can hopefully see that this one is a little, the bottom one here is a little different than the top two. And even there's a difference in color. So these actually are both female. Yeah, you want to hold that one up a little bit there, Steve. And you can see that the, you know, the ovaries tend to be reddish or pinkish in color. And you can definitely tell if you open it up, you can see the little tiny dots in there that mm-hmm. will be eggs. Like I said, each one of those. So they're just very full of those. And this one, you can see, though, you want to be careful because it doesn't always look the same. So this one is a little redder. It's probably a little less mature at this mm-hmm. point, a little smaller fish. See, this one's got a large stomach here, too, that's probably eaten recently.
Maybe even that first part of our dissection, you know, our digestive system was pushed down.
More like,
it's not,
yeah,
right?
It's more like this one, yep. Yeah, where she's probably further along in her reproductive cycle, so the gonads are so large, they've basically pushed everything out, where you can clearly see the stomach and intestine more on this fish.
Yep, so we're actually going to use that male to kind of go through the parts again. Just
and then this one now, so we didn't see male, you can see the difference in the male gonad, the testes, how generally white it is, and it tends to have a smoother appearance across it, glossy almost mm-hmm. appearance. And so, and this one's quite large. They're not, the testes are quite large, not always that large. Sometimes they're, you know, quite a bit less. So again, this was probably a breeding season mm-hmm. animal getting ready to, because since they shed the sperm externally, they produce large amounts of it, because very little of it's going to be able to reach the eggs.
Sure.
And so, yeah, I think if we'll just, although as we were doing in the other ones, we'll just kind of lift that out. And you can see sperm, or the testes are paired, so there's one on the other side as mm-hmm. well. And so we'll just take that one off. But you can see beautiful. This one has a very nice digestive tract. Here's the beginning here. Here's the, I can't quite get it to come up here. Come on. The stomach area, let's see if we can make, there's the spleen. Okay, so here's part of the stomach here as this goes down. Here's the intestine looping around. There's the spleen, dark colored.
Very large.
Right there. And then the intestine would run back that way. And here, actually we didn't see this on the previous one. Here's a little bit of pancreas.
Oh yeah.
The pancreas always, you try to look, it's a small gland and it lies in the mesenteries between the intestines. So it's right there lying, it's this little structure. So it's kind of hard to find. I'd say I'd be careful if I had, you know, middle school students or something like that. I'm not sure I'd try to find that one so much. But it's an important structure that produces enzymes for the mm-hmm. digestion, you know, like insulin and things like that. So it's an important structure.
So it's nice to have multiple examples.
Yeah,
and
sometimes you'll see different parts. Good thing to have students looking and sharing, you know, things that they're finding between different ones. And then here's the liver again, up in front. And then here's a very nice heart, too. We saw before the heart lying just beneath the gills, just in front of the liver. There's the ventricle, the muscular part, and then the atrium right behind it, the more sac-like part.
One thing I was going to show the students here, too, is just the consistency of these two, as far as, like, if you pull this apart.
Yeah.
Compare that.
Oh yeah, to that. Yeah, cut that.
You can see the difference there.
Yeah, this is going to be very, again, part looks like little dots in there, little particles. It's very smooth, and they breaks very easily.
So kind if you of question stuff. Which one it is, you can kind of tell by that too.
Yep, you can tell.
Is that pretty much across most organisms?
Actually most vertebrates are at least you know outside of mammals and things. That would certainly be true. It's even true in reptiles. It's true in birds to a certain extent.
It's just an amazing organism.
Yeah, and I say it's a very good example. Again, I mean, they've got these, you know, basic vertebrate system, very similar to ours in terms of the characteristics. They're very well adapted for this aquatic way of life with their way their body is shaped, the fins, the gills for extracting oxygen, the way their digestive system functions. They're very, and obviously very successful animals.
Well, thank you so much, Dale.
Oh, great. They're great fish. It's fun to take a look at them.